assistant professor at IIM Kozhikode, and he will be talking about perspectives, look at the role of the Indian regulator in the private sector in expanding financial access to the poor.
Please.
Respected season chairs, Professor Sudipto Sarkar and Professor Anup Kumar, dear participants. I had actually earlier been working in the bank for around 14 to 15 years. Then at the age of 41 plus, I decided I'll quit the job. And then I went ahead and did my fellowship at IMC. It took around another 6 years. I had to survive there. And just it's around being like I'm here for teaching for last 2.5-3 years now. So during my research as well as all my other papers had been with respect to empirical earnings and purely based on deep banking credit aspects. This is my first attempt to look at a financial inclusion, and I'm trying to go ahead and coming up with some theories on this with respect to the again banking concepts only, and that's why this is a perspective paper. This is again my fourth presentation on this paper. I had started with a very raw concept and I developed it based on all feedbacks which I got from different participants, and based on that I'm still working on it. I think I will need at least another 2 or 3 presentations before I can come up with a final perspective or theory, etc. So I'm open to all your suggestions, and I believe that that will help me a lot with this. Yes. So my paper, typically, I look at the activities of Indian regulators and then the private sectors towards, currently this is what my perspectives are, and looking into trying to expand the financial services access for the poor. And this is again in context of India only. So what I am looking here is typically in terms of measures, impacts, policies, the barriers and promotions. Again, I'm looking into what India has done or what has been done in India with respect to the past, present, and I'm looking for further actions in the future. Again, I had tried to merge both the frameworks with respect to all these things, with respect to the policies and principles. So this is what my perspective is, and I'm looking into this aspect only. So why this perspective and why I'm looking into these things? So if I look into the G20 FIEG 2010 conference, they conclude, there they started saying that most of the individual country settings, almost like they are the 2/3 of the regulatories and supervisories are now typically burdened with the responsibility of enhancing the financial inclusions. Since then, we can say that the importance of financial inclusion and with respect to the measures impact has gained much importance. Even when we look into our India also, we'll come to that, but the importance again comes with mutual objective of like we're trying to reduce the amount of time and money, increasing the capacity of the poor with respect to the weathering, what you say, absorbing the financial shocks, looking for like in generating income opportunities, income generating opportunities, and above all, the most important thing is coming up with macro level efficiency by trying to digitally connecting what even today in the morning Professor Arun Kumar was giving much talking about digital importance only. The same thing here also it is coming up. The efficiency by digitally connecting the poor people, financial institutions, government service providers and the businesses including the private sector. So the mutual objective of the G20 nations was also with respect to financial inclusion is most of the most important objective is this. So when we look into this part, like I have only 10 minutes, I'll be very quick with other parts. So the access to financial services typically has 3 parts. We can say that with respect to who gets offered what products at what price. So if you divide that, then what we are left with is these suppliers, the users, and the product. So again, the current scenario with respect to the World Bank global financial barometers, last year, they say that 78% of the people surveyed, they indicated that the financial inclusion has improved substantially in the countries in the last 6 years, particularly if you look into India. Till November 16, we had opened over 500 million BSBDA accounts, and this process started with more free accounts in 2005. Then we came up with the Jan Dhan Yojana, which started in August 2014. In fact, the financial inclusion thing started in a big way from 2014 only, whereas the RBI, for the first time, if you look into the RBI annuals reports, we find that for the first time, they talk about financial inclusion only in around 2007. So again, this one, Jan Dhan Yojana, contributed over 174 million till May 2016. So again, the question is still, why we are looking into this aspect, why my perspective on financial services access, the thing is what importance it is again having. It is typically, if you look into it, it gives the opportunities of best investments to looking into like channeling funds to their most important, what we say, productive uses, like growth, income distribution, and poverty reduction. On the other hand, on the contrary, financial exclusion will typically put a brake on such developments. And if we look into it, the theories, different theories also suggest that financial market frictions typically again start generating poverty drives and slower growth. So that way we say that expanding financial service access is now very much important if you actually want to develop economically a nation. Other than that, again, there are several opportunities in terms of business, etc. Particularly the private sector, they can look at the huge untapped market potentials with respect to financial services. Together, it can also bring in enough good innovative solutions. Again, still then, there are some responsibilities also with respect to the public and the private sectors, because we look at both the supply and demand things. We find that to do that, this market requires action, and as well as the leadership from the public sector is also required in this case, which will bring incentives to the private sector, so that both can involve in a much more way. So if we make a list of all these aspects of, with respect to the opportunity, with respect to the responsibilities, etc., with respect to expanding the access, we will have to look into the following few aspects, like the access, the limit access, the indicators of measuring the financial access, the barriers, importance, and how to evaluate the impact and the role of regulators in building such inclusive financial systems. So if we summarize six aspects, we can simply say that we need to have knowledge of the following three factors: major impact and policy. So I've divided the remaining paper in two parts. The second is the major impact and policy, and third is the Indian actions with respect to past, present, and future. So the second part, typically when we go for major impact and policy, we find that typically with respect to measures, we have now have a global FinDex, which has been developed by the Bill Melinda Gates, and they have given some 40 indicators, which include geographical and economic factors. But still then we find that the most important thing is the income and education with respect to particularly the demand and user side determinants, which needs to be measured in a much bigger way if you want to measure the impact of your financial inclusions. RBI has taken a step in this case with respect to business facilitators, which has been doing a good job. Then the second is with respect to the impact, to understand the growth, what you say, constant to growth or poverty reduction. In this case, particularly Beck paper says that financial access actually promotes firm growth, and the impact is higher, particularly when you find that access to financial services through different formal channels are finally made, the impact is much higher for startups. There is better dynamism, there is innovation and equilibrium size respectively also. And the third factor is policies. So in this case, it is most important that this is where we have to understand the role of the regulators, including the financial system. But to understand the policy, we also need to implement the policy in a better way. We also need better principles for effective government, control on the policies. And this will also definitely boost what is known as sustainability of the financial inclusions. So what we need is now a proper implementation of policies and principles. The government in 2014 came up with some principles to look into this aspect, but before that, the government leadership view to, if we need to understand the implementation perfectly, then what we need is a government leadership. Typically, I'll take 1 or 2 more minutes. Yeah. Highest level, we need to have a government leadership and commitment. This is essential to ensure that there is a strategic financial sector growth and development. And again, if we look into it to understand or to look into this, to ensure that this becomes perfectly implemented, we need reliable data and knowledge, which I'm also collecting for last 3 years. I've been doing that before I can come up with a better theory or perspective on these policies over the time. Then again, the policies, if they need to be implemented perfectly, we need new technology and innovatives also. But also when we are looking into this aspect, the most important focus has to be on the market failures. We have seen that the new accounts which have been opened do not have enough balances, or the pension scheme which has been started have not become popular. So we need to focus on policies which can remove such market failures. That is one of the aspects which need to look into more importantly. Other than that, we have to look into different other regulatory frameworks. The list is going on. Like we can have to look into regulating business conduct, overseeing recourse management to protect consumers, etc. But I just now said that RBI in 2014 first time laid down 4 design principles with respect to implementing the policies. These are the stability, transparency, neutrality, and responsibility. So I won't look into that, but the thing is that these principles are complementary and should be considered together. And they are not exhaustive, and they are still evolving. Even the RBI is saying that still evolving. Globally, we find that several nations have come up with different principles. The G20 has its own sets of around 20 principles, and all these things are evolving continuously. Based on all these policies and principles, RBI finally adopted a bank-led model, and we now have what is known as one more paper will be presented on payment banks also. Later on, I've seen that. So we have seen that this bank-led model typically saw that the main big banks had failed miserably in typically improving the financial access. So we have now moved to differential banking. That is what is happening. So Indian scenario, the past I am not talking about. The present is typically with respect to there are 3-4 barriers which we need to look into: the psychological barriers, the physical barriers. I don't have the time to discuss all those. Then comes the regulatory barriers, and as well as the fourth one is very important. In this case, the fourth is the inculcating the private sector, including the with respect to impact investments and social finance, which are very much necessary if you want to include the financial access. So based on this, then there are some more aspects. So this is the 14th. They come up with 3 motives, which I do not want to talk about. But the important thing here is that the committee suggested multiple models, and the RBI accepted, went for the bank model, but the finally we went with the alternative private and public banking framework, and this is where we are working right now. So the final challenge for the future is like the most important thing is like the BCs with respect to the MFIs, the post banks, the post office banks, or the public distribution shops with respect to the payment banks. We need to ensure that there is enough, they are viable, they have enough adequate, there are enough adequate incentives. Our further challenges are with respect to the 50,000 villages, which needs to be covered. And the thing is that, again, whatever we provide, in the long run, how much sustainable they will be. So we talked about it says the biggest problem is with respect to the direct cash. So that one needs to be digitalized. There are four aspects which needs to be have to be looked into when we try to go for digitalization, moving from cash based to digital based transactions. And then again, if we look into that, finally, the combined effect of all these interventions can be, in a very simple way, can be looked into as a four initiatives: payment system with right scale size, regular financial services at right scale and size, partnerships with new differential private players, and research and innovations. So that is how up to I have stopped here only, because again, this is still with the future paper is still working.
Thank you. Thank you very much. One question, please. Anybody?